the previous lesson, the saddhā, we couldn't finish it. And before that, I gave you a sutta called Kālāma Sutta, for objective teaching given by Buddha. Because Kālāma Sutta is how it is said in Sri Lankan version. Sri Lankan is very famous in fact. But one thing mentioned in the Chattasangayana version, the name is Kesa Mukti Sutta. Because if you type even Kālāma Sutta, it may not appear. So Bhante said, they were taught in the class, BAB class, right? That BAA class. Kālāma Sutta is, another name is Kesa Mukti Sutta. Kesa Mukti
Sutta.
Diploma you study.
Diploma.
Because in Sri Lanka it's very famous Kālāma, that's why I said this name. So now we'll go to the same today's handout, significances of faith, right? And also there was we have a discussion about the merits and its wish. I'll come to that point again. Before that, we'll finish the saddhā lecture. Significances of faith advocated in Buddhist teachings and practice, because faith is something called believing. So Buddha mentioned about teaching, understanding was the final aim in his teaching. So how does faith, what sort of a role faith has in the teaching? That is very important to understand. So to my understanding, this is also a certain kind of analytical study done in faith. I find few significant aspects of faith mentioned in Buddhism. There are few significant characteristics of faith introduced in Buddhism. First and the foremost, as explained in the Bhima Sutta, is faith is supposed to be gained after thorough investigation. So Buddha mentions, if you want to have faith in me, this is the way to investigate. He asked the disciples to check him and then comes into conclusions about himself. Also, you can find the Chanki Sutta, a similar type of a procedure is explained. Belief without investigation, it means just believing what others say is called amulika saddhā. So the term is amulika saddhā. The Buddha mentioned that such sort of faith can either be correct or wrong. There are two possibilities. You may believe some others say, it can be correct, it can be wrong. So there are two possibilities. Faith gained through proper and wise investigation is called akharavati saddhā. So this is the proper, this is similar to the 28.10. I have mentioned this faith, akharavati.
So number is different.
Sorry?
Or is it
Okay, sorry, the numbers of your paper are different. 1.10, akharavati saddhā, it's the faith gained through investigation, thorough investigation. This is firm and unshakable by normal means. Buddha mentions, if you gain such a faith with such investigation, you will have very strong, solid confidence about the Buddha and his teaching. In the Chanki Sutta, if you go to the Chanki Sutta, the term saddhā is mentioned in two places. The beginning, a person may have his saddhā, ruchi, akara, parivitakka, ditti, nijjana, kanti, and anusara, these five. So saddhā is mentioned there. That saddhā Buddha mentioned can be correct or wrong. Then a person who has his preference, beliefs, considerations, his own ideologies, his own what he has heard, all these information, a person can have these things. He may have his own views. But the Buddha mentions, a wise person, even he has such ideologies developed by himself through his investigation, should not come into conclusions that these are correct and others are wrong. Because we have to understand our limitations. There can be other beings who can progress more than us. So a wise man may have his ideologies about certain phenomenon, but he should not, the most safe is not to come into conclusion that I am the one who knows correctly, others, all others are wrong. So then the Buddha encouraged, for such a person, if he wants to progress more in finding the truth, find out if there is a spiritual leader who advocates, teaches certain doctrines, go to them, approach them, investigate their character with the teachings they are presenting. And investigate the teachings, find out whether they encourage for good or bad, how you define, whether your defilements will increase or decrease,
Will it support your investigation, wisdom and so forth? After such an investigation, you may get faith. So the second place also he explained about faith. That faith is gained through investigation. First faith is just believing what others see. So in Chanki Sutta, you find two places with faith. One faith is Amulika Saddhā. Second faith is Akaravati Saddhā. So it's mentioned the first saddha refers to Amulika, whereas the second saddha gained by associating and examining the teacher refers to Akaravati Saddhā. That is the point. Then a question may come. It should be also mentioned that for beings who have investigated the profound phenomenon thoroughly and gained Akaravati Saddhā, in past lives, so for example, a person may have investigated and developed saddha in past lives. In later lives, saddha can occur suddenly just by hearing about the news of triple gems and by nature, as a natural nature. He's pointed out the mistake in the handout. If you could go to 1.13 and 1.14, the ball letters, what is written in ball letters should go up and down. Adigama saddha, not the whole paragraph. Only the part written in ball letters, these two words. Only the two words, not the whole paragraph. Two words should go up and down. It means Adhikama Saddha should be 1.13. Agama Saddha should be 1.14. But the explanations should remain. So my numbering also wrong according to your handout. Sorry for that. So suddenly, just by hearing about the news of triple gems, that is 5.1.12 and 5.1.14. So saddha can occur suddenly by hearing about the news of triple gems. 12 and 14. So suddenly, just by hearing about the news of triple gems, that is prasada saddha, or by nature, from as it happened from life to life, to like to Mahabodhisattvas. Such types of faith are still considered as akaravati. That is the difference. We read some stories, some beings get saddha suddenly without much investigation. So this happens because of the influence of the past lives. So or still we don't call it amulika saddha. It's very different, difficult to distinguish such beings. For example, Anathapindika, the rich merchant, the Buddha's main devotee, Mahakappin, who became an arahant, Mahakassapa, who just saw the Buddha and had his faith. It is mentioned in the Sutta. So these are called influence of their past life saddha. So that is called prasada saddha. And by nature, that what this bodhisattva gets, he doesn't need to investigate the phenomenon to understand the rebirth in some lives. So such types of faith are still considered as akaravati, as saddha attained to investigation, since they are obtained due to the influence of the practice done in the past lives, and such faiths are regarding the actual phenomenon of the existence. So we don't consider it as amulika saddha. Then a question comes forth. How about the people who become Buddhist by culture, by their family? What sort of faith do they have? Most of them have not attained saddha through investigation. Does their faith fall into the category of prasada saddha or agama saddha, or is it amulika saddha? Right, we mentioned saddha without investigation is amulika. Right, saddha by just hearing is prasada. Saddha which comes from by nature, life to life, is agama. So how do we understand? The answer to this question should be given analytically. If a person, for example, if a person has developed faith in past lives, strong faith in past lives, in this life, he may be born into a Buddhist family. Just while hearing the teachings, he gets strong faith. So maybe he is a person who gets the prasada saddha, influence of the past life. Think about such a person is a Mahabodhisattva, a great one who is practicing to become a Buddha and who has practiced long time in samsara. So such a person may get naturally faith upon this phenomenon. So it's very difficult to distinguish culturally what sort of faith do they have. Now, so that's why I say if a person who becomes a Buddhist due to the culture has the influence of the past life practice, if so, he gets faith upon triple gems and actual verities as soon as he listens to the Dhamma, then his saddha falls into prasada saddha. If he has been well trained Mahabodhisattva, then his faith can be called agama saddha. If he is none of the foregone two personages, not a person who has practiced in past lives, he's not a bodhisattva, then his faith can be, then it should be mentioned that at the initial stages of his belief, at the initial stage, just becoming a Buddhist because his parents are Buddhists, at this stage, it should be considered as amulika saddhā. Right? It's amul. It's not very baseful faith. This is what I. This is my understanding. This is how I explain this. So we can consider it amulika saddhā. But if he progresses in the Buddhist path, listening to the Dhamma talks and applying the spiritual practice into life, at a later stage, his faith will fall into okappana saddhā. 1.11, okappana saddhā. 1.11 is the faith which arises when the mind plunges into profound phenomena while he is thinking and believes them as if understanding them. This is with the Dhamma knowledge and your practice, you get such faith. So a person, a normal cultural Buddhist, if he progresses in the Dhamma, he listens to Dhamma, understands Dhamma, studies Dhamma, practices Dhamma, his normal faith will come into okappana level of faith. Right? It's a strong faith. If he investigates teachings deeply, it will turn into akaravati, the saddhā gained through investigation. Right? That is also a point. So till his faith reaches to the level of okappana or akaravati saddhā, strong faith, it is easy to convert such a person into a believer of another doctrine. So that's why when someone becomes out of culture, it's faith, Buddhist out of a culture. Out of culture means not much thinking, understanding, just for because of the family is Buddhist. His faith is not considered as very strong. So very easily they can be converted, or they may give up the ideas and comes into other doctrines. Right? So it is also very important. Otherwise, so we cannot just deny, look down. A person becomes a Buddhist by culture. Maybe he's a person who has practiced in past lives. We cannot say it. Or maybe he's a bodhisattva who is born in under such a culture. Or maybe he may develop, listen to Dhamma, and comes into higher stages of saddhā. It is possible. So we have to analytically answer this question. Another noteworthy feature of Buddhist faith is practice introducing Buddhism does not end in faith itself. That's the next point. Faith is important in Buddhism, but it doesn't end up with faith. So if we write that Buddhist practice in 5 steps, you know, write as saddhā, faith, then virya, effort, sati, mindfulness, samadhi, and panna, concentration. Right? Concentration and wisdom. So these are the 5. We can write the Buddhist practice in 5 steps. So initial step is the faith. Initial step is the faith. So at this level, you may have accept the theory. So this faith have few levels. Some may just believe the doctrine. Some, having investigated the Buddha's teachings, Buddha's character, then get the faith. Some study the teachings deeply, thinks, understands it, and then gets a certain solid faith. Some may get faith because of his past life influence. So there are various types of faith at this level. But this faith is still the initial part of the practice. What are the final goals? There are 2 goals explained in Buddhism. Samadhi and Panya. Samadhi is an achievement. Panya is an achievement. Samadhi, achievement of Samadhi is Jhana. You know, the Jhana is the absorption. And Abhijnana. Abhijnana is the supernatural powers, like psychic abilities to read others' minds, see the past lives and so forth. The achievements of Panya is Magga, Path and Phala, fruition. So these are the achievements of Panya. So this is what have to be achieved. So faith is believing in the beginning about the phenomenon, about the path. This path may give results. But this faith, we have to understand there are levels of faith. That's why in the previous paragraph I have explained, because some just believe because the family is Buddhist, they will go into faith. But this faith is not enough for a person to take to such levels. He has to study the Dhamma, he has to investigate, he has to think about it and how to apply this practice. Faith has to be increased to levels of akaranati, okappana, and so forth. Why the faith is important? Why put effort? Because we have a belief. If we have a doubt, our virya, it is going to up and down time to time. So therefore, more the solid the faith is, more solid the virya will be. More solid you putting endeavor in the spiritual practice, mindfulness is getting stronger. More the mindfulness is getting stronger, more easy samadhi and panya is guide. The thing is, now I'm talking about the aspect of faith. This is the beginning. It's not going to end here. Faith means believing, accepting some profound phenomenon which is beyond our experience. These phenomena will be proven to us. That's the point. Will be proven to us in this path towards these achievements. If someone attains the abhijnana, he is able to see how the karma works. And he'll be able to see the results of karma, how these things are happening. Then, in the way to vipassana and to magabhala, at a certain level, you get rid of the doubt about the rebirth, about the karma and its effects. Even without looking at the past life, you get into a strong confidence in this path. So therefore, the difference of faith in Buddhism than others, it is not going to end. For example, if you talk about a religion which is only based on the God and expecting the grace of the God to go to a certain destination, we are just ending up our life with just a hope, just an expectation. But Buddhist practice, some may not reach the far level, but if you talk about the practice as a whole thing, in the progress, this faith has to be verified to ourselves at a certain point of this practice. So, when you come to samatha achievements of abhijnana, observation of past, future lives and karma vipaka is possible, seeing the Buddhas and also possible. And in the vipassana practice, also you get rid of the doubts about the past, future lives and the effect of the karma. So that is the significance of the faith, that faith introduced in Buddhism is not going to end. The practice in Buddhism is not going to end in the faith itself. It is at a certain level, the what is believed have to be proven if someone wants to achieve the higher stages. Because if someone is going to get the Magapala at a certain level of vipassana, he has to get rid of the doubts about the rebirths and so forth. Another point is, now we are talking about a faith. Through faith, we achieve the achievement. And then another point, the Buddha has also recognized, it's a very good point, Buddha has also recognized two types of practitioners. One, in this path, spiritual path, from the beginning to the end, One person's practice is governed by his wisdom. He's a wisdom type person. From the beginning, he wants to understand the point, why it is, logic behind it. So he will have many questions. So these types of practitioners are there. So their wisdom is the main reason why they go to the highest. The achievement. So these are called Dhammanusari. You can see this word, Dhammanusari person. Dhammanusari. The next thing in the Buddha's teaching is, this is the one point that I really appreciate the Buddha as a teacher. He doesn't only recognize this person, he also recognizes there is a person whose faculty is predominant by the faith. Is called saddhānusāri. Saddhānusāri means he walks the path mainly basically because of the energy of the faith. Faith is his fuel. that takes him towards that final destination. How these two types of people are explained in the doctrine? It says, the person who has wisdom, in the path, when he talks about the vipassana, he sees the reality very clearly. His investigation is very deep. His vision is very wide, broader. But a person whose faith is more predominant, still he has to see, no one is going to attain higher stages just because of faith. There should be understanding, experiencing has to happen. But his experience is lower than the person of Dhammanusari. It says he will have a vision, but not like the person who of the wisdom character. He'll still have a vision. It's more, less deeper, it's not less wider. But still, he may go to the end. So therefore, there are two types of characters which in the path, we start from saddhā and we end in the wisdom or the samadhi. But the practitioners, while they are walking, there can be two types of beings, like whose wisdom faculty is more predominant and whose faith faculty is more predominant. And also when you come to the bodhisattvas, it is also mentioned, there is a bodhisattva with a wisdom type bodhisattva, like our Buddha. Then there is a bodhisattva like faith type bodhisattva. Then there is another bodhisattva with the virya is more problem. Effort. Three types of bodhisattva. It says, three bodhisattvas, same moment if they start their journey to Buddhahood. This faith type of bodhisattva will take nearly double of the time of the bodhisattva whose wisdom is more predominant. It will take more time because the wisdom type bodhisattva, he investigates the things clearly and he is able to achieve the task very easily. But a saddhā type bodhisattva may take long time to come to that level. A virya type, his energy is more predominant, his understanding is lower, faith is also not very strong like the other bodhisattva, but he strives hard. He has faith and he strives hard a lot. He may take four times nearly to the time of a wisdom type bodhisattva. So therefore, even we explain these teachings in such a manner and in an analytical way, it is not necessary for all the yogis to come into such analytical studies, because according to the Buddha's idea, he recognizes both the types of beings can come into final understanding. But the thing is, inevitable thing is, you have to verify whether you are a saddhā type person or a dhamma type person. Understanding has to come at a certain level. So faith in Buddhism is not going to end with faith. It is going to end with understanding. So the next thing is, in this part, why do we put virya? Because the faith, more stronger the faith is, more stronger the virya will be. Therefore, faith is an essential factor in Buddhism. So faith in Buddhism is a very significant type of a belief. It is necessary. It is essential, but it is not the end. So what happened is, in one explanation Buddha mentioned, an arahant who has attained this level is called asaddhu. Asaddhu means who has no faith. No faith means, actually it's not proper the translation, no faith, who has gone beyond the faith. When Upali, Chitta, the lay disciple, Chitta is name, not the mind, this is name of the person, Chitta, ascetic of other beliefs asked him, Venerable Gautama explained about such an attainment, do you believe in it? He said, no, I don't believe in it. So then he said, you see the very famous disciples of Gautama, he doesn't believe in what the Gautama said. Then the Chitta said, no, it's not I am believing it. I don't need to believe it, because I already have attained it. And even I have attained a higher state than what you see. So I have gone beyond the belief. So here what it is mean, asaddhu means, he is not just a person who depends on belief. So when you come to the end of the practice, you have a faith, strong faith, solid faith, but you are not depending on it. But the practitioners in their path, in the initial stages, You may have certain understanding, certain experience. As long as it is not fulfilled, not accomplished, completed, you have to still depend on the faith. So that's why in Buddhism, faith is something, a very significant type of a belief. It is necessary in the path, but at the end you overcome the faith, overcome means goes beyond the faith, and you comes into experience. And the next thing is, what is belief in the faith, by faith, saddhā, cannot be proven in an empirical way to others. This proving happens to yourself only. It cannot be proven to the, how to say, to the others. I gave a very nice example. Venerable Ananda Metteya was asked this question by one gentleman while he was giving a Dhamma talk in England. He asked the question, you are talking about rebirth, Venerable Ananda Metteya, very renowned scholar in Sri Lanka, and he said that he saw his past life, he has lots of spiritual experiences, I have listened to his Dhamma talks, and he claims about how he had certain experiences, and he said, he mentioned how he lost them even. So he's a very humble person. He lived for 100 years. He became the leading monk in Sri Lanka at a certain time. He lived for 101 years. Very healthy person, and he was very humble kind of person. So in a normal Dhamma talk, he explained how he had the samadhi when he was young, and how he was able to read the other's mind, and how he verified it, how he proved to himself that when people used to come to him to ask questions, before the people asked the question, he used to say, this is the first question you are going to ask from me. So he verified to it himself, and he says also, one time he was invited to a temple to make, this is his own words, I listened to him with my own ears in a recording. He says that he was invited to a ceremony, don't look down on ceremony in a temple. So it was so busy in the temple. So because a friend has invited him, he went there and he had no time to meditate. And then what happened? After the ceremony was finished, he lost his all concentration and he couldn't get that ability again. And he said he had a grudge towards that friend, the monk friend, for a long time. And then it took long time for him to overcome his anger. And then at that latter stage, he said, now I have no anger. I'm a person with full of metta. I don't have any thing because I know all things are impermanent. So he claimed that he wants to be a Buddha one day. And he has lots of spiritual experiences. So one time when he was giving a Dhamma talk in England, one person asked a question. One day you are telling about the rebirth and so forth. Can you prove it? You are talking about rebirth in Buddhism. Can you prove it? So because this cannot be proven, what the Thera did was he put a counter question. He asked the gentleman, okay, I'll give you two options. You think about rose or jasmine just for a while. Then you, okay. Now can you now tell me what did you thought of? He said, I thought of rose. So can you please prove me that you thought of rose? Impossible. So he said, likewise, some phenomenon cannot be proven. Spiritual experiences cannot be proven to others. It is proven to yourself. So likewise, he says that you know that jasmine, you thought jasmine, and there's no doubt for you at all. So likewise, some phenomenon like the rebirth, like the karma and its effects, so these are proven directly to you, but for others you can just give hints, you can give explanations that convince others, but you cannot make others to believe it, you cannot make others to know it. It has to happen through your own experience, right? So this is also one point that I want to emphasize about the saddhā. So I'll then move on to the sati. Sati is a very important mental factor. Sati is normally translated as mindfulness. There is a wrong belief that sati is equal to memory. Actually, memory is something that has happened many of mind moments. Memory means recalling something from the past or recognizing something which comes in front of you. So there are two aspects of memory. When you see a similar person, a person you have seen before, you recognize this person. This is also part of memory. And you recall something from the past. This is also part of memory. So this memory happens with many processes of minds. But this here we are talking about sati. Sati is one mental state, mental factor, which allows the mind to be wholesome. So that is what is explained in this paragraph. So I'll be reading some parts of it. Sati is the mental factor which acts as a power which stops the mind stream from flowing in the unwholesome side, establishes the mind stream, it means mind stream, in the wholesome side and prevents it from going back into the unwholesome side. So this sati prevents our mind from going into the unwholesome and drags it to the wholesome and makes it to remain in the wholesome side. The nature of the consciousness stream of sentient beings is to indulge in unwholesome acts. It's called papasmin ramati manu. Buddha mentions our mind always indulges in unwholesome deeds. Very easy to appreciate. In order to prevent it from indulging in unwholesome acts, the mind needs to have a certain mental strength. We all know, as people who are striving for spiritual growth, how difficult it is to practice good deeds. It is very easy to practice unwholesome deeds. So there should be a strong mental power, courage to do it. This power in the wholesome side is given by sati. That is the point. Sati is the power which holds our mind in the wholesome act. This also needs discussion, because there are lots of interpretations about sati in modern days. I will come into that at the end of this topic. So when the mind stream is prevented from unwholesome acts, it naturally becomes wholesome. That is the nature. If you prevent it from the unwholesome side, it becomes wholesome. That is the nature. For instance, a person who has been indulging in sexual misconduct, because it's normally it's considered as one of the high pleasures. So if someone can easily get indulged in that act, finds out the meanness and the danger of his evil conduct, then he prevents his mind from such an unvirtuous act. Such unvirtuous act, he prevents his mind. So, volition or the samma kammanta, abstaining from bodily bad acts, and that arises restraining from that act or the sexual misconduct, is called the sila. Restraining is called sila. This is also a very important point we have to understand. Just not doing bad acts is not considered as sila. For example, if you think about an ox or a cow who doesn't do any harm to any being, even it doesn't eat a worm, it just normally eats the grass, doesn't fight with others, is a very humble type of a being. So what do we think? This cow or ox, does it practice five precepts? Because he's not killing, he's not stealing, not sexual misconduct, because there are no marriages among cows, so there's no lying and no alcohol. So is he practicing the five precepts? Buddha mentions, you can read this in the Samana Mundika Sutta, in Majjhima Nikaya. He doesn't give the simile of cow. The simile was given by me. So, similar thought of explanation, Samana Mundika Sutta. He mentions, not just doing the akusala is not going to make you, a virtuous person. So, if someone wants to have sila, what does it mean? He has to have the intention of preventing, restraining from certain acts. This may be done because of religious purpose, because of another doctrine. For example, in the Christian doctrine, there are lots of good habits that are advocated. Don't lie or don't harm others. So if someone restrains from such a religious point of view, still it is considered as sila. Buddhists may restrain because of the karma, law of karma and effects, and also because the Buddha has made. Still it is called sila. Some people may restrain because it doesn't suit their family. But still, restraining from such acts is considered sila because he doesn't indulge himself in bad acts. Some people may restrain from such acts because intellectually he understands, without any religious purpose, he understands as his moral ethics, he knows killing is not good. So that's why some intelligent people argue, you don't need religion to make people good. This is something can be understood by normal intelligent beings. So therefore, it is true in one sense. You don't need religion to make all the humans virtuous, because even being people who can think deeply or think widely, broadly, maturely understand these acts are immoral, and we are not human. As humans, we are not supposed to harm others. We have to live a peaceful life. So still, according to Buddhism, this is considered as sila. So another point is, what is Buddhism is for? The next point. Buddhism is not just to make the people or the society a good place. It is Buddhism has another specific goal, is to stop the cycle of rebirth and suffering. So religion, in terms of Buddhism, religion or there is a philosophy or whatever it is not just for the sake of make the humans a proper society. It is an outcome of this religion. Buddha, five precepts were not advocated by the Buddha. It existed in Indian society even before the Buddha. Buddha recognized it. Buddha accepted it. And Buddha said, this is a good, proper conduct. And dana, giving charity, was not introduced by the Buddha. It was having been happening from the long time from the history. Buddha recognized it and he said, it is a good conduct. Respecting the parents, taking care of the parents was done in the ancient culture. So he respected it and he appreciated it. So likewise, if someone wants to have sila, something I went further away from the topic, I'll come back to the topic. The sila means restraining, like with a determination or with an understanding that I will not be doing unwholesome deeds. Just mere absence of unwholesome is not considered as sila. So what happens here? In order to thus establish the mind in the wholesome side, one needs mental strength. It is given by sati. After the mind has been established in the wholesome side, still it needs to be guarded from falling back into the usual unvirtuous habit. Because we mentioned about sexual misconduct, it may go back into that bad habit unless you guard it properly. Fine. How to guard? For that, one needs to regularly remind himself about his already observed sila. You have to remind yourself, I am such a person, I have observed such a virtue. I'm not supposed to do it. Dangers of already abstain evil act. If I do such a thing, these results will come. I have to endure such results. So it's proper to restrain, and benefits of restraining from it. If I don't do it, I will have the mental peace. I will have the pleasure about my own conduct. I can be a happy person about my own character. So these are the benefits. And also, I will not be disgraced by the society, which is a real mental burden if we get condemned by others. When such recalling often happens, the mind stream will remain in the wholesome side unshaken. This type of beneficial recalling is done by the mental factor called sati. Sati always reminds you about your proper mental state, your wholesome deeds. It is a power which prevents the mind stream from falling back into unwholesome habits. It is like this, for example. If I make this lecture, if I deliver this lecture thing, holding a glass or a glass bottle on my hand. So while I'm delivering the lecture, I cannot use my hands freely as I do now. Because if I make a mistake, this glass bottle is going to fall down and break. I have to, while I'm delivering, giving the talk, I have to always constantly be aware of this box, glass bottle that can easily break. Sati is like this. Sati means keeping certain standards in your life. It means, for example, how sati is applied to virtue, to a monk, for example. Monk's example is very easy. For instance, monks have lots of rules promulgated by the Buddha while eating, for example. So, if someone wants to observe all this sila, so while he's eating, he's focusing on the food, he's eating, but there is a certain awareness of his mind. That he knows, if I do such a thing, if I lick the fingers, this is considered as an offense. We cannot touch another ball with the hand with food. If there is food left over in the lips, we cannot take it from the tongue. We can take it like, we have to take the lip inside the mouth and take it. There are a lot of etiquettes given by the Buddha. For example, we cannot talk while the food is in the mouth. We cannot open the mouth before the food gets close to the mouth. We cannot put the tongue out, eat something. We cannot throw the food into the mouth. A monk cannot recall them all the time. It is impossible. You cannot live a monk life because monks have thousands of rules. So what we do is, after we have learned, we keep them a certain awareness. So when someone is talking to us while we are eating, sati quickly recalls us. You have to first finish what is in your mouth before you talk. So this is the sati. Sati doesn't mean that sati normally in these days it introduces that you are focusing on what you are doing. It's a one aspect of sati. But for example, a cat, look at a cat who is going to attack a bird, how focused he is. A person, a sniper is going to kill a victim. He has to focus for hours to get the target. He's well focused, well attentive about his task. Just being attentive about what you are doing is not sati. Sati means being aware, whatever act you are doing, whatever act you are doing, being aware, not the mind to go into the unwholesome side, not the letting the mind to go into the break the sila. For example, someone determines, I will not have loba today, or I will guard my mind from craving. From whom he is talking, to whom he is looking at, he has to always have a guard in his awareness, in his mind, that if I go beyond this mark, loba will overcome. So always sati is reminding you that the determinations you have made to yourself. That's why I gave the example. I'm giving the lecture holding a glass bottle on my hand. I'm giving the lecture at the same time. Glass bottle is like my sila or like my mind. If I use it unwisely, it will fall down and break. So sati is like always guarding or being aware, not only being aware of what you are doing, being aware, not letting the mind to go astray into the unwholesome side. This is called the guardian of the mind. So this is how sati is explained in the Buddhist teachings. Yes, yeah.
So in order to guard our mind, yeah, we first have, should have a judgment.
Yes.
First judge, this is great or wrong.
Yes.
But yes, when we
exactly, you're correct,
practice meditation, teacher always instruct us, don't do any judgment, you just observe what happens.
Oh, this is some, you're talking about a meditation subject. If I come into that point, we are talking about now, we have to shift the attention toward the vipassana, right? So you are telling me is like, it's a very good question, it has to be answered. It's like, but the idea which came to me is, if I'm going to answer, it's going to take a long time. So if I give a brief answer for that, it's like judging and not judging, right? There is nothing called judging and not judging in Buddhism. I know these are ideas that have come forth later generations, after the 1950s, I would have to say this. So there are ideas that in vipassana meditation, you don't judge things as they are. So these are not, you cannot find these in doctrines. Buddha has never mentioned such things. Okay, if someone says, don't judge an object as a human, as a man, as a lady or a woman or a man, something like that, this is something can be acceptable. But in the observation, if something is unwholesome, it has to be known as unwholesome. Such ignorance, just denying the existence, is not explaining Buddhism. You have to accept, you should know what it is. The thing is, in vipassana meditation, you have to observe the three types of characteristics. It's very basic like that. So if we bring that, I'm not going to explain what another teacher says. I'm not looking down on other teachers. But what I want to say is, vipassana meditation explained in Buddhism is exclusively four, three characteristics, and I would call five types of characteristics we observe. That is impermanence, suffering, non-selfness at the latter stage of the meditation. And in the beginning stage, you focus the realities as realities, their intrinsic nature. Then the impermanence, suffering and non-self. Another characteristic is conditioned characteristic. And another sixth characteristic, which is not discussed at all today's vipassana teachings, is the attributes of Nibbana, contemplating the attributes of Nibbana as an encouragement to further. So this is the limitation of vipassana. If someone says, don't judge your object and all, according to the knowledge that way I teach, explain the Buddhist doctrine, there is no way to, I cannot explain it how it is. So I would say vipassana meditation is exclusive to these six attributes. Like, you have to focus on these six attributes. judging an object or not is nothing to concern with it. Nothing to concern with it. But what you said is correct in the first place, to my understanding. I mentioned that when you are guarding the mind, first you should have distinguished what is good or bad. Yes. So Buddha mentions in one or two suttas, the beginning of the practice is because of two things. That is samadhi, the correct understanding what is good and bad, and your sila, that is for the spiritual guard. Because without sila, we are unable to tame ourselves. Sila in the spiritual aspect, it is the basic. But to come into sila, the view has to be perfect. So sati, saddhā, all comes based on this understanding and this sila. When a question may come, in this here we mentioned the wisdom, understanding at the latter. There are two types of understandings. Understanding the things in the beginning, roughly, like for example, you are listening to a lecture, we are thinking about something logically. It makes sense. But this kind of understanding is the beginning of Buddhism. So this understanding comes from listening to Dhamma, or discussing Dhamma, questioning Dhamma, and through a good friend who knows the Dhamma. So that's why Buddha mentioned, associating a good person is the way to get the Dhamma. Then you have to investigate, question, keep on asking questions, and try to understand the Dhamma. Then it will come, yeah, it makes sense to me. Then these understandings will distinguish what is good and bad, and then we make the determinations, I will abide with the good and abandon the bad. For that, we have to have sati. So as you are correct in that, you are correct what you said, sati needs premeditative determination. Right? Sati needs premeditative. But for the other question, as you said, not judging in meditation, I'm sorry I'm unable to answer that question, because it's not how I would explain meditation. Yeah, we have to conclude the lecture, we'll finish with the sati. So as explained by the elder Nagasena, sati has two distinct characteristics. So this is given by in the Milinda Panha. Apilapana lakkanam, upagandhana lakkanam. Characteristic of reminding beneficial practices and observing them. It always reminds us. So these paragraphs give some practical explanations. When mindfulness is present, the person always remembers the spiritual qualities that he should frequent. For instance, when a yogi has made determination to practice meditation or to pay homage to the Buddha at specific times, sati reminds him about his wholesome determination. It all reminds him. Moreover, if he has made resolutions, more advanced resolutions to spend the day contemplating a beneficial meditative object such as the attributes of the Buddha or vipassana, whatever, sati frequently reminds him the intended object without letting the mind go astray in sundry objects. So when we have sati, we have determined I will be mindful or focus on this object the whole day, sati will always reminds you when mind is going out. In terms of precept, when a monk has observed various types of training rules, if he is mindful, sati will remind him about the acts that he is not supposed to do in order to practice his training of virtue. So sati is the reminder which reminds you what to do and to follow these things. Then upagandhana lakkana, characteristic of distinguishing good from bad and beneficial from unbeneficial. And the point is adapting the good and the beneficial to the life. This is also done by sati. Sati recalls and then we adapt such things. And we know, sati also knows what is good and bad. Before sati, what is good and bad is determined by wisdom. Another characteristic of sati is distinguish the good and bad acts, speeches and thoughts. When a person is mindful, he recognizes good behaviors from bad behaviors and abides with the good abandoning the bad. In the same way, it recognizes the beneficial behaviors and unbeneficial behaviors and try to adapt beneficial behaviors. Beneficial behaviors means even though some acts are not wholesome, it may not unwholesome, sometimes it can be unbeneficial, especially for monks and so forth. Right? Then, moreover, it recognizes the people and things that bring success to the life and spiritual progress from ones who and which that have negative effects to the life and practice and associates beneficial people and things. So this is what the sati recalls us about the good things that we are supposed to do, and it distinguishes good from bad and adopts the good. So these are the Venerable Nagasena's explanation about the sati. It was mentioned about that mindfulness is the power which holds the mind stream in the wholesome side. On the other hand, the mind of beings is naturally dragged towards the unwholesome side. Therefore, there is no necessity of a force like sati to keep the mind stream in the unwholesome side. You don't need a power to keep the mind in the unwholesome side. What you have to do is just release the power on the wholesome side. It will always naturally go. That's like a river flowing. But however, despite the fact that unwholesome sati is not necessary, the Buddha in number of suttas has mentioned the term nicca sati. As in the commentary literature of the tradition, the term is used denoting all sorts of unwholesome mentalities. Micca sati means all the unwholesome mentalities, and in the footnote I have given sometime it refers to the tanha associated with wrong view as well. So then there is a misconception about the ordinary Buddhist considering sati as the memory. Actually, memory is a mental act which happens with number of mentalities. Sati alone cannot act as the memory. However, when sati is strong, memory functions well. That is also we have to appreciate. Like, if sati is strong, your memory becomes very clear. As for the Dhammasangani Atitaramana Tika, there are 49 types of consciousness that can take past objects. So therefore, memory is not sati. Nevertheless, it should also be noted that within the literature, the term sati has been used, term sati, not the ultimate reality sati, term sati has been used referring to the act of memory as well. Satin katva, having remembered. In such usages, the term sati does not represent the mental factor that we have discussed here. So these are the points that I want to discuss. We found out the benefit, the significances of saddhā, faith in Buddhist teachings, and also some facts about the sati. The question that we discussed in the previous lecture, this further to comments, and we can have discussion on that. So I also got some thoughts while I was in the break, so I also like to share with it. So normally when we do a wholesome day, for example, we get the vipaka. So we get the vipaka out of a wholesome deed. So it seems like when we are doing a wholesome deed, good karma, kusala karma. Right? When we are doing a kusala karma, we are getting a result. So if we think about now, so the question came, if we are expecting a result, so what sort of a good deed it is? And also the CLA raised the question, whether this is sampajana kata or sampajana kata. At the moment, he doesn't think about his results. There are two types of considerations. One may wish for a result, that is one type. And one doesn't, he has an understanding about karma and his results. He may wish or he may not wish. Wishing and not wishing is not a reason to call the karma sampajana kata or sampajana. If he has a correct view, then the karma is going to give results. So this karma is considered as sampajana kata, right? That's how I would explain it. Then the question comes to wish. We make a wish to come into this point. Also, isn't it something like an exchange? It's a very good question. It's a very good logical type of argument. If isn't it an exchange, like you do a kusala, you expect a vipaka. It seems like buying and selling. For example, we give something and we sell, means we are getting something. Isn't it like that? You give dana because you are expecting. What I wanted to say in the previous thing, I mentioned that they are not similar. I think you also understand it is not very similar, but it has a certain characteristic of like expecting, right? Expecting. I'll just mention about few dissimilarities of this. For example, in a buying and selling, we give the good to the customer. If it doesn't pay back, what do we do? We will just shout at him, or we will charge him, or we will ask for it. For when we are giving something for a beggar, We have a certain expectation. That expectation is not that we are asking from him. We know, we are aware that, for example, if you don't wish, what happens? We have an awareness that this will give result whenever it is ready or whatever it comes. We are just aware of the natural process. So that is normally some Buddhists do, is they give, they are aware that something, the result will happen if the karma is working. So the question comes, if you wish for something. So wish for something is, now for example, it is something which is not very clear to all Buddhists, for example. Because the Buddha says, because the doctrine says, we may get such a result. What sort of a result? We are not aware of it. So therefore, he is making a wish, giving more emphasis onto the natural phenomenon of the which governs it. It is not just asking from that person. So that's why I mentioned that it is not very similar to this. He is just expecting it through a natural phenomenon. Through a natural phenomenon. But if you talk about the exchange, if it doesn't give me the result, we are not going to. So for example, we give to a beggar. If we don't get the result, we are not going to ask it back from him. Right? So likewise, it is not completely similar. And the next question, a good question that came from is, wish. How do we, the wish effective? Because the Sankharupati Sutta, I mentioned that the Buddha explained about that the wish is governing the karma. Actually, karma and result is a natural law. Karma and result is a natural law, which is not governed by anyone. So what the Buddha mentioned is, it is not going to happen because of wish. We can have a certain, I'm using the word certain, certain effect to this wish, effect to this phenomenon by a wish. But whether this wish will effect or not, it is also not certain. For example, some may do a karma. Karma is like a certain energy. It may give certain results. There are certain abilities of karma. Not all karma can give results as we wish. So therefore, what the Buddha wanted to say is, this is a natural process. A wish may have a certain effect to direct towards a certain where it is wished. But it is also, it depends on how strong the karma was and also other conditions are there. So it's not something out of full control. So the next thing is, the thing that if you are making a wish, a proper wish, for example, normally as teachers, we encourage people to make proper wish. Proper wish means being born in a good abode, because then you can have a spiritual progress. To wish to have good friends, so therefore you will have to practice properly. It is mentioned in the books that bodhisattvas wish for more wealth. For what purpose? So he can give dana more again. So he can develop his spiritual qualities. May I be born in a good family which is conducive to spiritual practice. So therefore, there are certain wishes that are appreciable, and then sometimes the wishes are governed by full of craving. For example, these wishes in Buddhism, they don't encourage such wishes. To conclude the lecture, I would say that there was a lady who wished, having offered, according to the story goes, she offered flowers to the Buddha, and he wished, may I be pretty as much as that whoever man looks at me goes crazy on me. So she wished for such. Then what happened? As a result of the karma, she got such a beauty. But thing was, she had also done some bad deeds. She was born in a very low caste. So what happened? It says, the story says, six princes saw this girl, got attached, went crazy. But they knew they can never get this girl because of the caste system. If they get this girl, they will lose their kinship or they will lose their privilege, because the caste system was so strong in those days. So what happened? It says they couldn't bear their desire. They suicide themselves. Then what happened, a very renowned teacher also got crazy about this lady, and she also got suicide. What the students of the teacher got really upset about it, they knew because of this lady, six princesses commit suicide, and our teacher also commit suicide. This is a danger for the society, and they rather than kill the lady. So it says that, it's not just mentioning about the story, that some wishes can be some too dangerous. And to conclude your story, I think you are aware of such a person. I saw it in the as a news that one person from an Arab country was deported. I was really shocked to get that news. He was deported because he is too handsome. Yeah, so this is how I would explain the karma and its results. If you have further questions, we can discuss in the next week.